Hey, today I'm making Polish black bread, which I don't know if anybody's tried pumpernickel bread, but it's kind of similar to that, but it's really, really good. I'm Polish, so I've been trying to get some recipes from my background, my heritage, and try them. And I tried this, two or three times before, and everybody loves it. So I'm making it again today to go with my congressional bean soup that I'm making. And, you know, I'm not doing these videos for money. I'm doing this because I think cooking is a dying art. And a lot of kids nowadays don't even know how to make a grilled cheese sandwich, let alone some of this other stuff. So I'm trying to help you along and try to teach you some of this stuff. I'm getting a lot of airplanes going over, so I'm going to cut this right now. For this recipe, you need 2 to 3 teaspoons of dry yeast, which I buy yeast in bulk from, I think it's Frontier Co-op online. I buy it by the pound because I make a lot of different things with it. You need some oil. I've just got vegetable oil. You need molasses. You know, I've got grandma's original molasses here. You need a good flour. I've got organic white flour, and I'm pronouncing this right, Ghirardelli unsweetened cocoa powder. I love this stuff. It's good for you. And you need a little bit of salt. So first I put 1.5 cups of lukewarm water into a bowl. This will activate the yeast, and I'm going to add 3, it says 2.5 to 3 teaspoons. I'm going with the 3. I can't do this one-handed, so hang on for a second. All right, I've added the yeast. I'm going to stir it a little bit into this. And it doesn't call for putting the molasses in with this, but most yeast really gets activated good if you add the sugar or some sugar to it when it's first getting going. So I'm going to stop and measure out some molasses. I'm going to measure 2 tablespoons of molasses. The molasses is dark and very thick, as you can see. So that will help to make this bread black, what they call black bread, and also the cocoa powder will darken it. It's not the yeast or it's not the flour that makes it dark. It's the molasses and the cocoa powder. It's weird because you don't really taste the cocoa powder. It just gives it a real rich, rich, really good flavor. So that's 1 tablespoon. It calls for 2. I don't know if you noticed before when I was stirring the yeast, it was sticking to my spoon. Take your finger or something, get the yeast off of the spoon and get it down in the liquid. Otherwise, you're wasting half your yeast. Okay, I put 2 tablespoons of molasses in here, and I'm going to gently stir this. And then we're going to let this sit, and it's going to, what they call proofing. You should see this yeast start to multiply, like foam up. If you don't, then your yeast is no good. And it should only take about, 10 to 15 minutes. And as you can see, there's things starting to foam up on the top already. But I'll show you that when it's time. I'm going to try to get most of that molasses off of here. So I'll be back when this is proofing, or done proofing. While that one's proofing, I'm going to go ahead and measure out my dry ingredients into a separate large bowl. So it's 4 cups of flour. And I'm not one that measures exactly. If it's a little over, it doesn't matter. See, it's a little bit over the one. This makes one nice big loaf. There's two. There's three. And there's four. Okay, so I'll put that flour aside. And as you can see, my yeast is starting to foam up. Okay, next we want 3 tablespoons of cocoa powder. I have the unsweetened cocoa powder. You don't want like Nestle's mix or something like that. You want the good cocoa powder. Okay, there's one. And you should level this. If you have 2 hands, take something and level it. But I'm trying to. There, I leveled it with my left and pinky finger. Okay, that was 3 tablespoons of cocoa powder. Oh, it smells really good. Okay, so there's my flour and my cocoa powder. And 1.5 teaspoons of salt. I don't like to use salt too much in cooking, but bread, you need it because it helps to do something to the bread. I'm not quite sure what, but there's a reason for the salt. Okay, that was my salt. So I've got the cocoa powder, flour, and salt. And I'm going to kind of mix this up till it looks the same color. I'm going to set that aside for now. So we've got the yeast is going with the molasses and water. I've got the flour, the salt, the cocoa powder over here. And once this foams up, we're going to mix that into the flour. And we're going to add some of the oil also. It calls for 3 tablespoons of oil. Whoops, sorry. And you can see what it's doing now. This has just been a few minutes, and it's starting to foam up here. And again, the molasses helps to feed the yeast and get it foaming up. So anytime you make bread, I try to put a little bit of sugar or, you know, if it calls for molasses, put the molasses in with it. And I'm going to go take a break now, have a cup of coffee, let this foam up, and I'll be back. I have this Wilton mat that I use occasionally to knead my dough or cut cookies out. It's nonstick and it saves the table. We've been stripping our kitchen table, so there's some stuff on there right now that, you know, like residue from the previous finish, so I don't want to knead it, however you want to say it, on the table. So we're going to knead it on this Wilton mat when the time comes. Also have a flour sack towel or some type of towel that you can cover your dough with while it's rising. As you can see, the yeast has foamed up quite a bit. So I'm going to go ahead and mix that into my flour. And it looks like all the molasses has stuck to the bottom, so I'm going to go get a spatula to get all that stuff out of there. Now I'm going to mix all this up, and I'm going to add the, 3 tablespoons of oil to this also. I'm using just vegetable oil. If you use too strong of a flavored oil, it may make your bread taste different. You know, if you used olive oil or something like that. You could use it, but be aware that it may change the flavor. Okay, this is what it looks like after I've mixed it up quite a bit. And now I'm going to put some flour on this mat, turn out the dough, and knead it for a while. I'll show you that in a minute. All right, I've floured this mat, turned this out onto it, and you may want to flour your hand a little bit, your hands. I'm doing this with one hand to try to show you, but use both your hands, and you're going to just use the heel of your hand, flatten it out, keep pushing, and then turn over a corner. And there's probably a certain way to do this, but I do my own thing. Fold it over, and again, flatten it out. And just keep like doing a quarter turn on it. And keep flattening it out until you get a real smooth surface on it. If you have to add more flour a little bit to keep it from sticking to your hand, do so. So, and then flip it over. This is just the way I do it. You do this for a while. It says to knead it until it's kind of sticky, which is getting sticky right now. You can see the color of it. It's really nice. Cocoa brown. Anyhow, I'm going to knead this for a while, or knead it, however you say it. I call it knead. And then I'm going to put it into the bowl, and we're going to let it rise in a warm spot until it has doubled in size. So I think this is about ready. I'm going to just take it in the bowl. It says to oil a bowl. I don't do that either. I've never had problems getting it out of the bowl. Put it in the bowl, cover it with your towel, forget about it for probably at least 45 minutes to an hour, sometimes longer. If it's a real cool day, you may want to let it go longer. I'm going to wipe the edge of this off so I don't get it all over my towel. That's sticky molasses. I keep one towel and just reuse it like several times while I'm making breads. And then when it gets dirty, I put it in the laundry. But I just keep it in a plastic bag to keep it clean and fresh. And that's what I do. And this is, it's like a flour sack towel, I guess you call it. And I'm going to put that aside and let that dough in there. You see the size of it now. We'll show you that later. We're going to let it rise, and it's fairly warm here today because it's going to rain, so it should rise fairly quick. So I'll get back to you later after this has puffed up and doubled in size. All right, it has been 1 hour, and look at that. Remember how small that was? They say if you put your finger in it like that and it stays, that it has risen enough. But I don't always do that. I just look at how it looks. So we're going to dump this out, flatten it down, and shape it. And I may have trouble showing you all that because I'm doing this one-handed, but I will try. Okay. You want to grease and lightly flour a cookie sheet or whatever you're going to bake it on. Or you can put parchment paper. I've done that already too, if you don't want to do that. Just cut your parchment paper to fit it and put it on there. So I've dumped it out, and it's really sticky, so I'm going to put a little bit of flour over the top of this. You can shape this more or less almost the way it is right now, like a round, or you can do an oblong or whatever shape you would like. I'm gonna go ahead and flatten this out a little bit. And bear with me, I'm trying to do this with one hand again. Someday I'll get a tripod. I doubt it. I'll probably never break down and get one. So you want to kind of flatten it out a little bit, get some of the air bubbles out of it. And I just get to about that point where it's pretty big and flat. And then fold over the ends. And there may be some technical way to do this, but this is how I do it. Fold the ends over like that, like a big burrito. Then bring that end in. And then this end here in. And you see how it's almost like an oblong shape already. And then kind of bring these seams together like I'm doing and pinch it. Pinch and pinch. So you don't have an open seam. You want it pinched together on the ends also. And just kind of shape it the way you want it. And I'm going to use my other hand now and try to shape this better. I'll show it to you. Anyhow, I've got mine oblong shaped. You can make it round if you want to. You can do whatever you want. Then I'm going to let this rise again. Probably 45 minutes to an hour. And before that time period gets done, I'm going to preheat my oven to, let's see, where is my temperature on this recipe? Hang on. It's probably on the back of it. I'm trying to flip it over. Okay. All right, you're going to preheat your oven to 350 and bake this at 350 for 35 to 45 minutes. So I'm going to cover it with my towel again and let this rise. There it is, all covered up. And I set the timer for 45 minutes. I'm going to look at it then. And once it rises a little bit, you can take an extremely sharp knife and cut some little slits in the bread to make it look more like store-bought bread. And it helps it. It just looks really neat. Makes it look more rustic. I'll show you that also. But you have to be careful doing that. Sometimes I'll do it ahead of time, like right now. And other times I do it after it has risen. You're supposed to do it after it rises, technically. But you can deflate your bread also by doing that if you're not careful. So, in other words, you don't want to poke it like a balloon. You want to go along the edge of the knife instead of poking it. So, I'll show you that. All right, it's been 45 minutes so far. And look at that. It's beautiful. I think I'm going to do the little slices in it, and I'm going to preheat the oven to 350 degrees. Okay, got the oven preheating, and I'm going to give the bread probably about 10-15 more minutes to rise. Okay, I'm going to do some slices in this. Not sure how many I want to do. Let's do three. And as you notice, I'm not going to poke it because that's going to deflate it. And I could still deflate it doing this, but I'm doing it very gently. And they actually make an instrument that you can buy, like at King Arthur Flour, to do this with. But there you go. Not very deep, but gives it a little bit more rustic look. It's going to open it up a little bit more, too. I'll show you that. Okay, I'm going to cover this back up and let it go for another 10-15 minutes. That's what it looks like before it goes in the oven. Notice how the slices in it opened up a little bit. It looks beautiful. Okay, I'm going to put her in. Recipe says, let me go around. I think it was 35 to 45. Let me check here. P says 35 to 45 minutes at 350. So I'm going to put this in the oven. I'm going to put it at the lower temperature or the lower time and look at it. So probably ended up doing it 35 or 40. 45 seems like too much to me. And when you put this in the oven, you want to, I don't think you can see that. Put it in the oven, be very gentle setting it down because you can deflate it, and be careful shutting your oven door. You can also deflate it by slamming the door. So do all those things and you should have a nice loaf of bread. All right, I ended up doing the bread the whole 45 minutes, and sounds hollow inside. And it wasn't burning on the bottom, so I let it go the whole time. Your oven may be hotter, though, so you may want to do it only 35 minutes. So just watch it and make sure it's not burning. And that's my beautiful Polish black bread. I'm going to take it off the cookie sheet and put it onto this rack to cool, so it cools evenly. Hope you try making this. It's really good. And it's going to go really well with my bean soup that I'm making. I also have recipes for the congressional bean soup on YouTube also. Try it and make some of the bread to go with it. Bye.